I kind of touched lightly on some of the things that we did, and you mentioned housing. And you remember, you saw in the newspaper a few weeks ago that the Housing Authority opened up their waiting list. Mm-hmm. Oh, I got a minute. I better make this quick. That they opened up. By the time they closed their waiting list, how many people were on there?
10,000.
30,000 people applied. And so there's a lack of affordable housing, so it certainly impacts individuals living with HIV and AIDS. But regarding the Affordable Care Act, no, we make sure that our clients are connected to the AIDS Drug Assistance Program, ADAP. And so that's, I'm not sure if I could answer that question, though, about, you know, the Affordable Care Act, but we know that a lot of the clients that we are serving have low incomes and have, and this is a complicated issue when I talk about HIV and AIDS, because it's complicated. When we have done studies, a lot of the times people say that transportation and economics are a barrier to getting services. Very good question. In 1981, it is assumed in the Congo and way back in Africa, you know, that is the but if you want to, I've had people ask me this question before, and I know about Tuskegee. I know about other theories that people say that, you know, is this a conspiracy? Okay, you may want to think that. My point is, the work that we're doing right now to prevent the spread of HIV. And we know that, yes, it started out in the gay community in the 80s and in the 90s. And then it spread. And when it spread into the African-American community, again, because of issues, lack of insurance, lack of access to medical care, it's the same disease that impacts the African-American community, like diabetes and high blood pressure, and it goes back to poverty and economic issues and having access to medical care and treatment.
Tom.
And I know that there's a health educator from the health department that goes into the school. But to beyond that, they are allowed, to my understanding, to talk about how to prevent HIV. I believe a part of the problem is awareness again, and education, and people think about Magic Johnson, and you really don't hear a lot about it. I have a young relative that's my son, 26 years old, and he talked about condoms. He said, every single time, Dad. And I don't know, I hope that because I've been talking to him for years, but I think to answer your question, is that young people just don't, it's just not talked about.
Yeah.
At home, and I'm not sure the level in the school system, if anybody's with the school system, maybe you can chirp in, but I think the basic problem is that it is just not talked about. It is a question. Did I know about it? And no, I did not. And I've heard about nanotechnology, and I've heard about other theories, but we know that what's in existence now that works and that helps people is being on antiretroviral drugs to prevent the spread of AIDS, to help a person reduce their viral loads and increase their health. And the problem is that a number of people who are living with HIV and AIDS, again, are living in poverty and don't have access to care and treatment. I'm getting ready to write a letter to the editor and hope to be, you know, have this published in the Observer, because year after year after year, recently, World AIDS Day comes and it goes and there's no recognition of it. And my goal is, again, is to bring more awareness, and I believe education helps to reduce stigma and discrimination. And I believe that is, again, part of the major problem is that it's just not talked about, and I believe that it's us working together that we can work to address this issue. So yes. And Ms. Stevenson, I forgot to mention that for the last, I think, 2 or 3 years, Mecklenburg County has issued a proclamation commemorating World AIDS Day. And aside from the county commissioners, where we do our regular reports, to city council, no. There's no education of city council. A board of county commissioners, yes, but not city council and other elected officials.
But there will be, okay, and the school board.
And the school board. And again, I cannot emphasize that, and I would guarantee you that most people in this room, the last time you talked about HIV may have been a long time, and I just think it's so important that we continue to talk about this issue, considering the impact that it's had. Ebola, ISIS, Jefferson, Missouri, all of these things need our attention. No doubt, these issues need our attention. But when we turn our back on HIV and AIDS, then we're turning our backs on our brothers and sisters who are being impacted by this, who are either living with HIV and AIDS or at risk of HIV and AIDS. And that's the reason Pat and Ms. Stevenson and Paul and others that I say there needs to be a 2015 AIDS awareness campaign. Again, we celebrate our 25th anniversary next year, and I do want to get the Foundation for the Carolinas and United Way and you to help support us, because again, if we keep putting, I told Pat earlier, it's not even on the back burner in some people's communities. It's not even on the stove when you talk about HIV and AIDS. And again, the simple conversation that I had with my 26-year-old son the other evening, and he said, each and every time, Dad, each and every time, I protect myself. Because we're not just talking about HIV, we're talking about herpes, we're talking about chlamydia, we are talking about other sexually transmitted diseases. And when I was growing up, it was gonorrhea, it was syphilis, it was pregnancy. Oh yes, you know, when we talk about when the impact on African American women.
Women, that's what I'm talking about.
Yes, oh yes, it again, disproportionately impacts African American women through heterosexual contact. And certainly, as I mentioned up here, with young, same gender loving men of color, the impact is through the roof.